Going under the microscope now, there's this new book out, and it's making a lot of waves. It's by economist Emily Oster. It's called Expecting Better, Why the Conventional Pregnancy Wisdom is Wrong. Got some pretty strong claims in this book, so we decided to investigate. We asked Dr. Jean Conria, who is president of the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, to take a closer look.
Most people love their morning caffeine jolt, but how much is too much? Oster says much of the evidence supports 3 to 4 cups as being okay. But Dr. Conry says, hold up.
Caffeine can be associated with miscarriages. So our recommendation is against any consumption over 200 milligrams of caffeine a day.
Those caffeine milligrams add up pretty quickly. 8 ounces of Starbucks has 165. A small McDonald's coffee, 100. A can of regular Coke, 35. And what about foods? Many pregnant women are warned about listeria. Oster says don't worry too much about sushi and raw eggs. She ate sushi. Oster does say avoid raw or rare meat, unpasteurized cheese, and deli turkey sandwiches. Conry says, why risk it?
Listeria is a bacteria that can cause miscarriages, stillbirths, and infections in infants.
Should pregnant women worry about gaining weight? Oster says you should probably be more concerned about gaining too little weight than too much. Conry disagrees.
Obesity is associated with birth defects, diabetes, hypertension, increased C-sections, a number of different things.
When it comes to pregnancy, maybe the biggest taboo is alcohol. But Oster says, relax. Quote, there is virtually no evidence that drinking a glass of wine a day has negative impacts on pregnancy or child outcomes. She does suggest a limit of 1 to 2 drinks a week in the first trimester. Conry says, don't even think about it.
We can't predict which mother is going to give birth to a child with fetal alcohol syndrome. It's safer to recommend against any alcohol consumption during pregnancy.
And joining me now from Chicago is Emily Oster. Welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
Sure. You know, and I'll preface by saying I think about this topic as a father and as a doctor, both. It's an intriguing book that you've written here, and I want to dive into a couple of these topics. When you talk about alcohol, first of all, I think that got a lot of people's attention. You say the bottom line is that women should be comfortable with 1 to 2 drinks in the first trimester. So you're an economist. You're not a doctor. I mean, what do you think people are going to take away from what you've written in this book?
So I think that one of the things I was most that pushed me to do this research is that I think that there's a lot of disagreement in practice. So many obstetricians will tell you, you know, a couple of drinks are fine. I think we're all sort of more cautious about the first trimester. But when you get into later trimesters, there's a lot of disagreement. And much of what I'm trying to do in the book is show women, here's what the evidence says. And I think that the evidence in some ways speaks for itself. I think many women will read this and think, you know, maybe I'm not going to have a drink. But I think when you look at the evidence on the outcomes for children of women who drink in moderation, they don't look any different than the children of women who abstain.
But to your point, the head of ACOG sort of says, look, we don't know for sure, but the risk is there, so why take that risk? Is that a reasonable approach?
I think that's very reasonable, and I think that many women do take that approach, and we take that approach in many things. So I think it's worth remembering, you know, we're talking about alcohol, but there are many things in pregnancy that we don't have perfect evidence on, and people evaluate the evidence for themselves, and they try to think about the right risk. And really, all that I'm trying to do here is really sort of show women, here is what the evidence is, and why don't you think about some of these decisions for yourself?
Finally, let me just ask, philosophically almost, I mean, the idea of mitigating risk, I mean, you know, I wear my seatbelt every day. If I don't wear my seatbelt, it's not likely that I'm going to get in a wreck and be injured, but it could happen, so I wear my seatbelt. This idea of mitigating risk, especially for a woman who is pregnant, do you worry at all that this could send the wrong message, that it's okay to do things that might carry even a little bit of risk?
So I think one thing we have to recognize is that we're always taking risks all the time, and that things we don't even think about. Like every time you get in the car and go on the highway, we know that's really risky. And a lot of people during pregnancy are taking non-essential car trips. And therefore, we're living with some level of risk. And I think all I'm kind of suggesting here is that a lot of these situations, you want to be thinking about what is the risk, what is the benefit, how do I weigh them? And we need to recognize that we're thinking about those choices all the time, whether or not we've kind of consciously accepted it. And there are maybe some situations in which we haven't thought about that explicitly, but we should.
You know, my mom, when my wife was pregnant, my mom always say, look, we've literally been doing this since the beginning of mankind. And, you know, for the most part, it works out okay. It's remarkable that babies are born as healthy as they are with all the various things that could go wrong. But I hope your baby's healthy. My three are. And thanks for joining us on the program.
Thanks so much.